Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents When Giants Ruled the Sky, The Brief Reign and Tragic Demise of the American Rigid Airship, by John J. Geoghegan, narrated by Tom Perkins. In this plodding commercial age, this day of humdrum money-grubbing and of the routine, though admirable, round of quiet duty-doing, it is a good thing, I think, for the few of us who can, to leave the beaten track, fare forth into strange fields, and strive mightily to do things which are exceedingly difficult and dangerous, and the more fascinating because they are difficult and dangerous. Walter Wellman, Airship Pilot, The Aerial Age, 1911. Preface. It is easy to dismiss the rigid airship as predestined to failure, but this explains nothing. Richard K. Smith, Airship Historian. Why listen to a book about airships? The answer is simple, because most of what we know about them is wrong. In retrospect, airships might seem like fragile dodo birds destined for extinction, but for the first 30 years of the 20th century, they were viewed as a more robust means of transportation than the aeroplane, consistently surpassing them in range, flight duration, and load-carrying capacity. By comparison, early aeroplanes were noisy, all-splattering affairs that could only carry a handful of passengers, flew mostly in daylight, were often grounded by poor weather, and crashed with alarming frequency. And yet the history of aviation remains focused on heavier-than-air, HTA, flight. It's not difficult to understand why, but it's a bias that overshadows some truly amazing airship accomplishments. Consider the following. In 1901, Alberto Santos Dumont, a Brazilian multimillionaire with soulful eyes and a penchant for depression, needed only 30 minutes to complete an 8-mile circular course around the Eiffel Tower in his No. 6 dirigible. What's more, the diminutive Brazilian did it 2 years before the Wright brothers flew at Kitty Hawk, an impressive display of powered navigable flight. To give the Wright brothers their due, their engineering acumen made them first to crack the code of HTA flight. Nevertheless, they were far from being the first men to fly, which may come as a surprise to many. Additionally, they weren't quite the heroes they're painted to be, as we'll soon see. In 1910, German airships began carrying paying passengers on a regularly scheduled route 4 years before the first scheduled commercial airline service began in the United States. In 1919, a British airship, the R-34, was the first aircraft of any type to make a round-trip voyage across the Atlantic, something no aeroplane of the day could accomplish. Although Alcock and Brown succeeded in being the first to fly across the Atlantic a few weeks before the R-34, they took a considerably shorter route, flew only one way, and made a very hard landing in Ireland. By comparison, the R-34's flight was smooth sailing. If that's not impressive, the R-34 completed her record-making flight 8 years before Lindbergh crossed the Atlantic on his solo one-way flight to Paris, and did so carrying passengers. In 1926, an Italian airship, the Norge, flew over the North Pole, marking the first time any land, air, or sea expedition incontrovertibly reached that destination. Despite Frederick Cook and Robert Peary each claiming to have reached the North Pole first in 1908 and 1909 respectively, neither claim was ever verified, and both remain controversial. In the case of Richard Byrd's 1926 overflight of the North Pole, he later admitted his navigation was faulty. In 1929, another German airship, the Graf Zeppelin, LZ-127, circled the globe 6 times faster than the first aeroplane to do so. 2 years later, the Graf commenced a regularly scheduled passenger service between Germany and South America with occasional stops in New Jersey, a performance no other aircraft of the day could match. Lighter-than-air, LTA, flight may be a withered branch on aviation's tree, but its history is important because it's where human flight first began. When Giants Ruled the Sky will not only correct many of the popular misconceptions associated with airships, but explain why so many people expected they would surpass ocean liners and transcontinental trains as the preferred means of long-distance transportation, especially for the wealthy. One popular misconception is that the Hindenburg, LZ-129, crash brought an end to the airship era. Giants will show this isn't the case. Additionally, the Hindenburg's fiery demise killed far fewer people than many of us assume. Of the 97 passengers and crew aboard that fateful day, two-thirds, 62 people, survived the disaster. This casualty rate of 35% was far lower than the major aeroplane, train, and ocean liner disasters of the day. Given 1,503 souls were lost on the Titanic, the Hindenburg's death toll of 35 is small by comparison. In fact, Germany remained so confident in the future of airship travel that she began flying a replacement, the Graf Zeppelin II, LZ-130, only 4 months after the Hindenburg crash, and continued to operate her for another 2 years. The Germans even had a sister airship under construction, the LZ-131, when the Second World War intervened. What most people don't realize is that before the Hindenburg disaster, German airships transported tens of thousands of paying passengers millions of miles without a single passenger fatality, a safety record unmatched by any other form of transportation. Although it's true that the number of deaths attributable to airship crashes was astounding when compared to the small number of craft that were built, airships were promoted by their adherents as the safest form of long-distance transportation. One reason so many people expected airships to become the dominant form of long-distance transport was that the U.S. Navy, in partnership with the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company and German airship manufacturer Luftschiffbau Zeppelin, were determined to sell the public on the speed, comfort, and safety of airship travel. Twice as fast as the speediest ocean liner, to which they were frequently compared, airships seemed ubiquitous during the 1920s and early 30s, appearing over Tokyo, Washington, D.C., Rio de Janeiro, the Egyptian pyramids, and New York's Empire State Building. The Empire State Building, the tallest skyscraper in the world when completed, was even built with an airship mooring station at its top. As a result, airships didn't just capture the public's imagination in the way the American space program would many years later. They held it firmly in their grasp for 3 decades until airplane technology matured enough to eventually overtake them. What may surprise the listener is just how close America came to having her own fleet of gigantic, globe-spanning airships. Designed to carry passengers, mail, and cargo, these behemoths were not only intended to fly from New York to California, but across the Pacific, the Atlantic, and down the length of South America. And yet, passenger ships ply the ocean today while commercial airlines flourish. Meanwhile, the big rigid airship is extinct. An explanation why is long overdue. One reason airships seemed destined to succeed was that between 1917 and 1935, the United States Navy poured tens of millions of dollars into an experimental program that built a series of increasingly sophisticated dirigibles, larger and more expensive than anything that had ever flown. The biggest of the lot, the USS Akron, ZRS-4, and her sister ship, the USS Macon, ZRS-5, were so large they equaled the RMS Lusitania in length. 14 stories tall and 2.5 football fields long, these self-contained cities in the sky could venture aloft with an 80-man crew for days at a time when an aeroplane's range was limited, ocean liners slow, and no railroad truly transcontinental. There was only one problem. The Navy's airships kept crashing. Even when the Navy was warned that its airships had a potentially fatal design flaw, it refused to listen. When it became clear the design flaw had caused at least one of its airships to crash, the Navy covered up the truth rather than risk further embarrassment. The purpose of this book is to delve into the two most critical years in the Navy's big rigid program, April 1933 to February 1935, and ask the question, what the heck happened? Why, after spending millions of dollars and years of effort, did the fate of the American airship come down to a brief 23-month window? Central to the answer are the heroic contributions of 4 men instrumental in building the Navy Zeppelins, each a giant who ruled the sky. Rear Admiral William A. Moffett, the first chief of the U.S. Navy's Bureau of Aeronautics, who envisioned a fleet of gargantuan military airships patrolling the Pacific to prevent a surprise attack by Japan. Paul W. Litchfield, CEO of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company, who not only wanted to build Zeppelins for the Navy, but also a fleet of passenger-carrying airships that spanned the globe. Goodyear Zeppelin's chief airship designer, Dr. Carl Arnstein, who, having built Zeppelins for Germany to bomb London, was determined to design the world's safest airships for his former enemy, no matter the obstacles put in his path. And the Macon's enterprising captain, Lieutenant Commander Herbert V. Wiley, upon whose shoulders the fate of the American rigid airship would ultimately fall. Each one of these four men shared the same hope for the future, a fleet of U.S.-flagged dirigibles that would extend American military and commercial hegemony from sea to sky. This dream not only ended up killing one of them, but would irrevocably change the lives of the other three while leaving a lasting mark on aviation. Sadly, the contribution of these four giants is little remembered today, despite their having once been famous. That these four men fought to overcome seemingly insurmountable odds to achieve their goal suggests just how extraordinary, if little known, the story of the American rigid airship really is. But first, a word about definitions. There are three types of airship: non-rigid, semi-rigid, and big rigid. Most people are familiar with non-rigid types. The Goodyear blimp, which flies over sporting events, was a good example for many years. Goodyear retired its non-rigid blimp fleet in 2014, replacing it with semi-rigid airships. Blimps are designated non-rigid because their envelope contains no skeletal framework. Instead, their shape is determined by the pressure of the lifting gas inside. Non-rigids also have a gondola slung underneath, which houses the pilot and passengers, along with one or two engines mounted on their outsides. Next come semi-rigids. Semi-rigids incorporate a keel in their envelope, giving them added structural strength. As a result, semi-rigids can be built larger in size than non-rigids, allowing them to lift more and fly farther than blimps. But even then, semi-rigids don't approach the truly gargantuan size of the rigid airship. Whereas the envelope of a non-rigid or semi-rigid is shaped by the lifting gas it contains, the envelope of big rigids like the Akron, Macon, and Hindenburg are given shape by an enormous skeletal airframe. This enables the crew to live and work inside a big rigid's hull, unlike a blimp or semi-rigid where passengers and crew are confined to the gondola underneath. A big rigid's airframe is critical to its design because it supports a series of gas cells inflated with helium or hydrogen to float the airship. The reason why big rigids had to be so huge was to contain the enormous amount of LTA gas necessary to lift their sizable weight. Although a big rigid's heaviness may seem counterintuitive, it's required if the airship is to be sturdy enough to transport a large amount of people and cargo considerable distances for days at a time without landing. To give an idea of a big rigid's mind-boggling size, the Hindenburg was approximately 140 times larger than the Goodyear blimps of her day. She had to be, not only to transport 100 passengers and crew thousands of miles while serving gourmet meals in luxurious accommodations, but to transport a substantial amount of cargo, which not only included cars, but a piano for shipboard entertainment. In contrast, blimps can only carry a few people 200 or 300 miles. Only big rigids, like Germany's Hindenburg or America's Akron and Macon, were robust enough to cross an entire ocean or continent. As for the difference between a dirigible and an airship, there are none. The terms are interchangeable. The word dirigible is derived from the French verb dirigeable, meaning to steer or direct. So any LTA craft that has an engine which propels it forward and a steering mechanism like a rudder can be termed a dirigible. As for the word Zeppelin, it's a brand name used to describe airships built by Count Ferdinand von Zeppelin's company, Luftschiffbau Zeppelin. Considered the father of the big rigid, Count Zeppelin and his firm built nearly 200 airships for commercial or military use during the first 40 years of the 20th century. Since then, the word has evolved to represent an entire category, just like Kleenex, Xerox, or Hoover. For our purposes, though, Zeppelin refers only to airships conceived and built by the German Count and his eponymous company. Despite being largely overlooked, the early days of LTA flight produced a diverse number of craft, many of them awe-inspiring, both in size and design. Even today, airships permeate modern life in unexpected ways. Take, for instance, the rigid airship in Pixar's animated movie, Up. It's based upon the USS Akron and her sister ship, the Macon, two Navy dirigibles that could launch and retrieve their own aircraft in mid-flight. Finally, as much as When Giants Ruled the Sky is a factual history, there is a fair amount of personal observation sprinkled throughout. For example, as a child, I never understood why the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company had blimps. Those giant gas bags with their winged foot logos didn't seem to have anything to do with tire manufacturing. Hopefully, Giants will not only explain why a blimp fleet makes perfect sense for the company, but why it continues to operate them today. If it's hard not to be moved by the sheer size, grace, and beauty of big rigids, it's equally difficult not to be impressed by the courage and determination of the men who designed, built, and operated them. Nevertheless, airship history rarely receives the respect it deserves. The USS Akron and Macon may be sterling examples of white elephant technology, but that only makes the story of the men who struggled to build and fly them all the more inspiring. In summary, Giants intends to place rigid airships in their rightful heroic context. It's not only a reappraisal of the reason for their demise, but a celebration of the passion and daring of four larger-than-life figures whose efforts made the American big rigid possible. In other words, explaining why the airship went the way of the dinosaurs is at the heart of this story. And the interesting thing is, it had nothing to do with the Hindenburg. Part 1. A Giant in Flight, USS Akron, ZRS-4, 1933. 1. Admiral William A. Moffett, A Giant in Winter. Rear Admiral William Edgar Moffett may have been a giant who ruled the skies, but the 63-year-old chief of the Bureau of Aeronautics, BUAER, felt more like a lion in winter this dismal Monday morning. It was 2 April 1933, and the sky outside his window in Washington, D.C.'s Navy Department was claustrophobically low, its clouds a leaden shade of gray. Like it or not, the weather fitted the admiral's mood. Responsible for overseeing every aspect of naval aviation, Moffett was not only BUAER's first chief, he'd headed it for a dozen years. A champion of flight at a time when the field was still young, Moffett was considered the father of naval aviation. His crowning achievement was to persuade Congress to fund 1,000 airplanes and 2 big rigids for the Navy, the largest purchase of aircraft ever made at the time. The congressional appropriation not only put naval aviation on the map, but saved a number of American aircraft manufacturers from bankruptcy, transforming Moffett into a national figure. Even in his waning years, Moffett made a striking impression. Although he rarely smiled for the camera, favoring a stern, granite-faced expression, he was a handsome man. His high forehead, well-proportioned nose, and cleft chin lent him a patrician air that was reinforced by the pipe never far from his mouth. Not especially tall, Moffett's military bearing added inches to his height while his snow-white hair encircled his head like a laurel wreath, adding to his imperious effect. As intimidating as Moffett appeared, there was little doubt his rigid airship program was in trouble. Some people wondered why the admiral placed so much importance on the Navy's big rigids when airplanes were the coming thing. Nevertheless, Moffett was proud of his newest airship, the USS Akron. Nearly 3 football fields long and 14 stories tall, the Akron was meant to patrol the ocean to forestall a surprise attack by Japan. In the meantime, her younger sister, the USS Macon, was set to make her first test flight in just a few weeks. Moffett had heard the complaints about his big rigids. They were too expensive, accident-prone, and vulnerable to being shot down. They only flew when the sun shined, and more recently aircraft carriers had made them obsolete. The last was ironic, given Moffett was instrumental in developing carriers for the Navy. Moffat argued that airships were complementary too, not competitive with airplanes, but fewer people were buying his story. It didn't help that the Navy's first big rigid, the USS Shenandoah, ZR-1, was ripped in half by a violent thunderstorm over Ohio, killing 14 of her 43-man crew. The Navy's second big rigid, ZR-2, also suffered a horrible demise when she collapsed in midair during a trial flight over Hull, UK. 44 of her 49-man crew were killed, including 16 of the 17 Americans on board. In contrast, the USS Los Angeles, ZR-3, flew for nearly 8 years, making her the most successful big rigid the Navy had ever operated. ZR-2, which the U.S. purchased in the U.K., crashed before she had a chance to be commissioned in the U.S. Navy. As a result, she's usually referred to by her British designation, R-38. To add to the confusion, ZR-2 crashed in 1921, while ZR-1 wasn't commissioned until 1923. The Los Angeles had gone a long way towards putting concerns about Moffett's rigid airships to rest, but the Akron, the Navy's newest big rigid, had suffered a series of embarrassing mishaps calling Moffett's program into question. An astute politician, Moffett had hoped to dispel the concerns by inviting members of the House Naval Affairs Committee, which funded his airships, to take a ride on the Akron. But as the congressman waited to board, the dirigible's tail broke loose. With her bow still attached to the mooring mast, the Akron spun like a weather vane, her tail dragging across the ground with a sickening crunch. The damage was so severe the flight had to be canceled. Worse, the Akron was laid up 2 months for repairs. As one congressman witnessing the accident remarked, "When I see girders snap off like pretzels, I know something is wrong." And then there was the Camp Kearney incident. When the Akron should have been celebrating her first transcontinental voyage across the United States, 3 sailors holding her mooring line were inadvertently pulled into the sky over San Diego. A newsreel cameraman caught the exact moment 2 of the men fell to their death, making for memorable, if damning, footage. After dangling from the airship for more than an hour, the 3rd man was pulled aboard. It was yet another black mark on the Akron's record that, along with rumors of substandard construction, continued to dog her. Powerful members of Congress felt the Akron was a white elephant, but Moffett was confident she'd live up to expectations if given a fair chance. His reasoning was sound enough. The Akron had been designed to scout thousands of square miles of ocean faster, more thoroughly, and at far less expense than the seagoing cruisers the Navy relied upon. Importantly, Moffett saw rigid airships as the best means to prevent a surprise attack by the Imperial Japanese Navy against the United States. America had been preparing for war with Japan ever since the island nation had stunned the world by defeating the Russian Navy at the Battle of Tsushima in 1905. That Japan could thrash a major Western power threatened the Big Four's hegemony, fueling racist beliefs about the coming Yellow Peril. Not one to think small, Moffett envisioned at least 10 ocean-going airships, the largest ever built, to serve as the eyes of the fleet. He already had 2 big rigids, the Akron, commissioned in 1931, and the USS Macon, ZRS-5, christened just that March. Whether he got the rest depended on 2 things: his ability to demonstrate the Akron and Macon were effective ocean-going scouts, and establishing a U.S.-based commercial airship industry to help build his aerial fleet. Until then, Moffett worried America was vulnerable to a Japanese attack. Moffett hadn't always believed in airships. "I confess to being a skeptic originally as to whether these gas bags could be of any value," he'd written. "But after I investigated the matter, I became convinced as to the ultimate desirability of their development." As far as their price tag went, he said his critics were apt to think too much about the money involved and too little about the benefits to mankind. Moffett had his work cut out for him. During the darkening days of the Depression, the Navy's battleship admirals considered naval aviation a threat since it competed with their precious surface fleet for scarce funding. This meant Moffett's airship program attracted a lot of sniping inside the Navy, which is why he felt putting over lighter than air has been the toughest job I ever undertook. Moffett may have faced increasing criticism, but he was well positioned to succeed. Two gold stripes, one thick, one thin, plus a star on his sleeve, gave him the clout he needed to get the job done. Spartan in taste and reserved in manner, he kept his emotions in check unless someone required a bawling out. But Moffat's southern charm helped contribute to his success. He was genuinely well-liked in the corridors of power, where he didn't just know who to put the arm on, but how hard to squeeze. A consummate insider, Moffat had an intuitive grasp of Washington politics. But his polite manner hid a steely determination. He'd even bypass his chain of command if it got him what he wanted. Moffat may have made it look easy, but it wasn't. Competing naval factions, inter-service rivalries, and the sclerotic nature of decision-making in Washington meant he endured many years of bureaucratic infighting. And yet he nearly always won. If Moffat had done more than anyone else to shape the future of naval aviation, he'd paid a steep price for it. Yes, he wielded tremendous power, but chief of BUAER was not a popular position in a Navy that was trying to figure out how to incorporate aeroplanes with its fighting ships. Yet Moffat had served 3 terms as head of the department, foregoing any chance of promotion. He'd also sacrificed his personal life. The father of 6 children, he'd been missing in action for most of his marriage. Remote and often gruff, he traveled so frequently he was rarely at home. His wife Jeanette, 15 years younger, was used to his being away. Prominent in Washington society, she enjoyed the power and prestige her husband's position gave her, if not always his presence. If Moffat's reputation as a ladies' man, earned at the Naval Academy, had carried over into adulthood, he'd been discreet. As it was, his marriage was more respectful than affectionate. His children suffered as well. As Moffat's eldest daughter recalled about the admiral, he made for a great Navy officer, but not a very good father. Serving his country had certainly taken its toll. As proof, Moffat had finally begun looking his age. In fact, he'd recently lost so much weight his features had thinned to the point of sharpness. One explanation is that he suffered from congestive heart failure. If so, few, if any, people were aware of his condition. Still, photographs show him looking drawn and frail. That's not to say he'd lost his command presence. On the contrary, he remained tough as nails. But after 42 years in the Navy, he'd earned the right to be tired. Moffat was proud of his accomplishments, but he'd ruffled some feathers along the way. Roosevelt wanted to reappoint him as chief of BUAER for an unprecedented 4th term. But Secretary of the Navy Claude A. Swanson had been cool to the idea. And so, after more than 4 decades serving his country, Moffat was slated to retire on his 64th birthday. In the meantime, he had almost finished building Happy Landings, his 40-acre retreat overlooking the Potomac River in Virginia. One thing was certain, he'd probably have difficulty adjusting to the quiet life after wielding power for so long. Moffat's impending retirement meant he only had 6 months to get his rigid airship program on a sound footing. This wasn't a lot of time, especially since the sharks were circling. The last thing he needed that gray Monday morning was bad weather to interfere with his plans. The reason the weather so concerned Moffat was that he was scheduled to fly on the Akron later that evening. The largest, most sophisticated, most expensive aircraft built in her day, the Akron was Moffat's pride and joy. He'd even invited a VIP to join him on the flight. But the increasing gloom outside Moffat's window had him worried the flight might be canceled. Picking up the phone, the admiral placed a call to Lakehurst, New Jersey, where the Akron was based, to make sure the flight wasn't scrubbed. Normally, the chief of BUAER wouldn't bother calling a base commander about a routine training flight, but Moffat wanted to make a point. It was no secret he felt his airship captains were fair-weather flyers. "I have a feeling," he'd written, "and have had it for a long time, that the ships have not been operated as much as they should." Moffat had gone so far as to say, "It may be advisable to take one out looking for bad weather, so we can find out what these ships can really do." Never shy about making his opinion known, Moffat had recently overseen the replacement of the Akron's commanding officer with a more aggressive airship skipper, Commander Frank C. McCord. McCord agreed that airships should fly in every kind of weather. After all, nobody wanted a big rigid that flew only when it was sunny, least of all Moffat. When the phone rang in Commander Fred T. Berry's office, Berry wasn't surprised to learn it was Moffat. The commanding officer of NAS Lakehurst was used to hearing from the Admiral. But when Moffat learned that the Akron skipper was in Berry's office, he asked to speak with him. Handing the phone to McCord, Berry let him know it was the Admiral calling. McCord had been the Akron's CO for only 3 months. Recruited from the fleet to command Moffat's next generation of dirigibles, he knew how much the surface navy looked down on airships. This is why McCord had embarked on an ambitious training schedule, hoping to show skeptics what the Akron was capable of. So far, they remained unconvinced. While Moffat inquired about the upcoming flight, McCord motioned to his executive officer, Lieutenant Commander Herbert V. Wiley, to get the latest forecast. After calling the base's aerological office, Wiley told McCord there was a possibility of scattered thundershowers later that night. The weather over their intended destination, Newport, Rhode Island, also looked poor, which might prevent them from accomplishing the tasks they'd scheduled for the next morning. Though Moffat's exact words are lost to history, his intent was clear. He wanted the Akron's 59th flight, scheduled for sunset, to proceed as planned. When McCord assured him it would, Moffat said to expect him before 1900 hours and hung up. With one seemingly innocuous phone call, Rear Admiral William A. Moffat not only changed the future of his rigid airship program, but the fate of the American airship as well.
2. Departures. Moffat departed Washington accompanied by his naval aide at 1300 hours. Normally, he preferred flying to Lakehurst Naval Air Station. After all, he was head of naval aviation. But the weather was sketchy. Not wanting to risk being grounded, he made the long drive in his staff car instead. When the Admiral arrived at NAS Lakehurst, nearly 6 hours later, the huge slab-like doors of Hangar Number 1 were already open. Inside, a gigantic dirigible, her airframe poking through her canvas-covered hull like the ribs of a steer, hovered off the concrete floor. That something larger than a battleship could float in the air seemed counterintuitive, as if the Akron thumbed her nose at gravity. And yet there she was, illuminated by overhead lights with a shadow beneath her, proving she was no magic trick. Moffat's car pulled into the Akron's hangar, followed by a shrill whistle alerting the crew to fall in place. While the men came to attention, their breath visible in the chilly night air, McCord greeted Moffat with a smart salute. NAS Lakehurst was the heart of Moffat's rigid airship program, but Moffat wasn't satisfied with having a dirigible base on the East Coast. He was building a second one on the West Coast as well. In the meantime, the culmination of everything America knew about big rigids operated just a few miles south of New York City. There was nothing small about Moffat's rigid airship program. From the size of its budget to the number of sky sailors it employed to the thousands of miles the Akron could fly without landing, no string of superlatives quite did it justice. There's no denying the Akron was a window into the future. A miracle of modern engineering, she was state-of-the-art for the U.S. Navy when commissioned in 1931. Some 785 feet long and 140 feet tall, she dwarfed everything around her, including her crew, which looked Lilliputian by comparison. Even King Kong, the giant ape in a new movie released the previous month, was a chimp by comparison. Size didn't mean she was slow, however. The Akron was the fastest dirigible the Navy had ever flown, with her 8 Maybach engines generating a top speed of more than 80 miles per hour. That wasn't as fast as aeroplanes of the day, but she didn't need to be. The Akron's job was to scout thousands of square miles for days at a time, which required range, not speed. Able to travel more than 10,000 miles without refueling, the Akron was a marathoner, not a sprinter. Incredibly, she was a self-contained city in the sky with everything she needed to keep her 80-man crew aloft for days on end. This included mess halls and a galley, 3 separate sleeping quarters for her officers, chief petty officers, and enlisted men, toilets and sinks, if not showers, a ward and navigation room, radio room, sick bay, smoking room, captain's cabin, and darkroom for developing photographs, all residing inside her enormous hull connected by a labyrinth of catwalks, stairs, and ladders. The Akron not only had running water, but her own power plant to generate electricity. 18 telephones spread throughout the ship assisted communication, while 8 machine gun emplacements helped repel attack. There was even a sub-cloud observation car that could be lowered on a cable to spy on the enemy below. Although the emplacements were ready, her 30-caliber machine guns had yet to be installed. If that wasn't impressive enough, the Akron was also a flying aircraft carrier. She not only carried 2 aeroplanes inside her belly, which could be deployed and retrieved in mid-flight to defend against attack, but a 3rd hung from a trapeze outside the airship. The world had seen nothing like it. Unfortunately, the Akron also suffered from the same high hopes with which so many firstborn are saddled. Although she'd been flying for 18 months, she had a long way to go before proving herself an effective ocean-going scout. One flight wasn't going to change that, but Moffat wanted to be on board that night if for no other reason than to show his VIP guest that rigid airships were a viable means of commercial transport. As if being a wunderkind weren't enough, the future of America's airship industry depended on how the Akron performed. If she demonstrated she could fly on a regular basis, despite inclement weather, then the financial community would feel comfortable investing in passenger-carrying airships. But if the Akron failed to live up to expectations, then the financial markets would steer clear of what they saw as a risky investment. Moffat had little choice. He had to show the Akron could fly in poor weather if he wanted an airship manufacturing industry to take root in America. Without it, there was no one to build his fleet of airships. That's why he didn't want the Akron grounded, because of a few clouds. Nothing in Moffat's early career suggested he'd one day become a giant of aviation. In fact, he'd once told a colleague, "Any man who sticks to flying is either crazy or a damned fool." Never a gifted student, Moffat had graduated from Annapolis in 1890 at the bottom of his class. During the next 30 years, he'd served on nearly every type of surface ship, from a wooden sailing sloop to a steam-powered dreadnought. In every respect, he seemed a traditional line officer wedded to the surface fleet. He'd even been awarded the Medal of Honor for his actions during the Navy's Battle of Veracruz in 1914. It wasn't until Moffat commanded the Great Lakes Naval Station that he realized the importance of aviation to the Navy. After observing pilot training up close, he became an evangelist with all the fervor of a recent convert. When he was named Director of Naval Aviation in 1921, he immediately began lobbying for a separate department within the Navy dedicated to flight. The key to Moffat's success as chief of BUAER was recognizing that aircraft carriers were key to integrating aeroplanes with the fleet. Able to transport planes places they couldn't reach on their own, carriers were becoming central to a Navy that had long favored battleships. Moffat knew aeroplanes made excellent fighters and bombers, but he also believed rigid airships could play a role. They not only had an advantage over planes in terms of endurance and load-carrying capacity, they cost far less than a heavy cruiser, the Navy's traditional ocean-going scout. It's important to note that some Navy cruisers also carried aeroplanes, but the cruiser's range was limited compared to the Navy's big rigids, putting them at a disadvantage when it came to scouting. Furthermore, airships could be repaired in flight, aeroplanes couldn't. Additionally, an airship remained floating in the sky even if all of its engines failed. In contrast, engine failure for an aeroplane often led to a crash. The steps leading to the Akron's commissioning had been anything but smooth, however. Things got off to a rocky start when the design competition the Navy held for its next-generation dirigible had to be repeated. Goodyear Zeppelin, a division of the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company, had won the first competition. But the company couldn't build its winning design at the Navy's stipulated price, so the competition was held again. Moffat preferred granting the contract to Goodyear outright, but Congress mandated competitive bids. Goodyear's president, Paul W. Litchfield, was not accustomed to losing, so it was no surprise when his company won the second competition as well. But if the process had been messy, the Navy contract was straightforward. It called for the Goodyear Zeppelin Corporation, a joint venture between the Goodyear Tire and Rubber Company of Akron, Ohio, and Luftschiffbau Zeppelin GmbH of Friedrichshafen, Germany, to build two rigid airships for the fixed price of $8 million. Luftschiffbau Zeppelin had built more than 120 Zeppelins by 1928, making them an expert in big, rigid design. It was natural for Goodyear to partner with the leading company in the field to build rigid airships for the Navy, but Litchfield never intended to build only two big rigids. He envisioned the Akron and her sister ship, the Macon, as loss leaders, the first step in Goodyear becoming the world's leading manufacturer of passenger-carrying airships. But the Akron had to prove herself before the commercial market materialized, meaning Litchfield was rolling the dice. When the Akron was finally christened on 9 August 1931, newspapers hailed her as Queen of the Fleet, Battleship of the Air, and Leviathan of the Skies. The ceremony, held on a Saturday inside the Goodyear Zeppelin Air Dock in Akron, Ohio, was deemed so important President Hoover's wife was named the airship's sponsor. The city of Akron even declared it a legal holiday so residents could attend. Some reports claim that between 250,000 and 500,000 people witnessed the event, although the New York Times pegged the number between 80,000 and 100,000. Either way, traffic was backed up for miles. The heat inside the hangar was so stifling, straw-hatted men and overdressed ladies fanned themselves in search of relief. Meanwhile, Goodyear sold blimp rides outside for a dollar, while a 500-piece brass band played Anchors Away. As attendees gaped at the silver whale floating overhead, they noticed part of her canvas covering had been peeled back to reveal her inner workings, as if labeling her refuse tank and ventilation system could explain the miracle of flight. Litchfield enjoyed the honor of escorting the First Lady to the dais. Mrs. Hoover, looking every bit her 57 years, sat in the front row, partially shielded by microphones. Heavy-set and frumpy, she wore a cloche hat and matronly dress as limp from the heat as the oversized bouquet she clutched to her chest. The viewing stand, adorned in red, white, and blue bunting, was tucked under the Akron's bow, which jutted 75 feet over the crowd like the prow of a ship. Packed with local politicians, Goodyear executives, and senior Navy officials, attendees included Amelia Earhart, who'd flown in for the occasion. Dr. Carl Arnstein, the Akron's chief designer, was also present for the ceremony. Arnstein was a modest man, not one to make exaggerated claims. He shied away from the superlatives newspapers used to describe his creation, claiming it was boasting before the baby actually walks. Litchfield sat in the front row next to the president's wife. Considered one of America's most powerful industrialists, he'd taken Goodyear, which had once been a small family-owned shop, from the brink of bankruptcy to an industrial colossus. Practically everyone in the country either bought Goodyear tires, recognized its winged foot logo, or had seen its blimps. If it seems odd that a tire manufacturer sponsored a blimp fleet, it was because Goodyear was in the blimp building business. In addition to manufacturing all six of its company blimps, Goodyear had sold another 9 to the Navy. Now Litchfield was celebrating the completion of Goodyear's first big rigid for Moffett's LTA program. This made the day as much Litchfield's triumph as Moffett's. After all, it was Litchfield's face on the cover of Time magazine that week. The illustration was so flattering as to be almost unrecognizable. As the accompanying article made clear, proud as he was about this week's milestone, Litchfield was frank in saying that the new Navy ship was but a means to an end, the building of commercial airliners to ply regular routes across the Atlantic and Pacific. The airship business never looked more promising. The Akron's christening was such a big deal that NBC Radio and the Columbia Broadcast System carried the ceremony live to tens of thousands of listeners. Litchfield was first to speak. Wearing a summer weight jacket and crisp white trousers, he looked big-boned and gawky in front of the microphones. After briefly outlining the history of lighter-than-air flight, he introduced the Assistant Secretary for Naval Aviation, who was smart enough to keep his remarks short. Then it was Moffett's turn. Resplendent in his dress whites, Moffat's job was to sell the Navy's airship program to a country hard hit by the Depression. Emphasizing the many new jobs the airship industry would bring, he ended his remarks by quoting Henry Wadsworth Longfellow's O Ship of State, a wise choice given the shaky times. "Thou too sail on, O Ship of State, sail on, O Union, strong and great. Humanity, with all its fears, with all the hopes of future years, is hanging breathless on thy fate. We know what master laid thy keel, what workman wrought thy ribs of steel, who made each mast and sail and rope, what anvils rang, what hammers beat, in what a forge and what a heat were shaped the anchors of thy hope. Fear not each sudden sound and shock, 'tis of the wave and not the rock. 'Tis but the flapping of the sail and not a rent made by the gale. In spite of rock and tempest's roar, in spite of false lights on the shore, sail on, nor fear to breast the sea. Our hearts, our hopes, are all with thee. Our hearts, our hopes, our prayers, our tears, our faith triumphant o'er our fears, are all with thee, are all with thee." The air dock's acoustics were so poor, few people grasped what Moffat was saying. As one wag noted, the only person who understood Moffat's speech was the admiral and the man who wrote it. After Moffat finished, the band struck up the Star-Spangled Banner and everyone stood to face the flag. When the final notes echoed through the air dock, Mrs. Hoover stepped to the cluster of microphones and, with Moffat and Litchfield looking solemn behind her, proclaimed, "I christen thee Akron." Though tradition dictates christening new ships with champagne, the country was in the midst of prohibition, and anyway, smashing a bottle against the bow of an airship seemed too violent an act for such a fragile-looking creature. And so Mrs. Hoover, reaching with her white-gloved hand, grasped a long beribboned cord hanging in front of her. Then yanking it down, two hatches dropped open in the Akron's bow, releasing 48 white pigeons, one for each state. As the pigeons emerged, some more reluctantly than others, the crowd cheered, the band played, and newsreels' cameras recorded the moment for posterity. To acknowledge the christening, the Akron was allowed to rise 6 feet into the air before being cranked back into place. It was the lighter-than-air version of a new ship sliding down the building ways into the sea, but the Akron was so massive, hardly anyone noticed she budged. Everything went downhill after that. It wasn't unusual for a prototype to fail to meet all its specifications, but newspapers made much of the Akron being over budget and 20,000 pounds overweight, a liability when getting airborne. Worse, it colored the perception that she might not be everything that was promised. Moffat was nothing if not accomplished at public relations. The day after the Akron was commissioned, he took 207 VIPs up for a flight, the most people that had ever flown aboard a dirigible at one time. It was a tangible demonstration of a rigid airship's passenger-carrying capacity, which must have pleased Litchfield. Soon the Akron was generating bold-faced headlines, coast-to-coast radio broadcasts, and breathless newsreel coverage every time she flew. Moffat made it a point to have the Akron appear over large cities hosting a parade so tens of thousands of Americans could crane their necks skyward to watch the future of aviation pass overhead. So popular was the Navy's newest dirigible, there was even a line of Akron souvenirs including pennants, ashtrays, bookmarks, and a children's cap to go along with a constant stream of newspaper, newsreel, and magazine coverage. We take air travel for granted today. But 20th century America was hungry for any form of transport that could span its vast continent and two great oceans. Germany already had one airship, the Graf Zeppelin, which was flying a regular scheduled service from Friedrichshafen near the Swiss border to Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, an astounding round trip of 12,000 miles. Why then wasn't the United States building its own airships to compete? The stakes could not have been higher for Moffat, Litchfield, Goodyear, and the Navy. Moffat's primary goal was to ensure the Akron was an effective naval scout, but he was not above promoting civilian airships as well. For this reason, he'd invited 50-year-old Alfred E. Maggery, vice president and chief engineer of Mack Trucks Incorporated, to accompany him aboard the Akron that evening. A lieutenant colonel in the Army Reserves, Majory had carved Mack Truck's distinctive bulldog logo out of a bar of soap before patenting the design. Looking like a bulldog himself, Majory was an officer of the International Zeppelin Transport Company, a Goodyear-sponsored firm mapping dirigible routes across the Atlantic. An avid believer in passenger-carrying airships, Majory didn't need convincing of their worth. Yet Moffat was determined to demonstrate the Akron could fly in all sorts of weather, knowing it would strengthen Majory's case to investors. Moffat and Majory boarded the Akron an hour before takeoff. As the sun dipped below the horizon, a heavy brown fog descended on the airfield. Lakehurst Naval Air Station may have been the Navy's premier airship base, but it had a reputation for poor weather. Carved out of coastal New Jersey's sand and scrub pines, the sparsely populated area was flat enough to make it ideal for flight operations. But Lakehurst was also smack dab in the middle of every storm blowing up the eastern seaboard. Moffat could not have chosen a better location for poor weather flying. As proof, the Akron's captain had visited the base's aerology office twice that day, seeking the latest forecast. What Commander McCord found wasn't unusual. A cold front was pushing in from the west, creating a low-pressure system near Ohio. Since it was outside the Akron's area of operations, he wasn't particularly worried. Still, one of the Akron's pilots, who'd flown up from Washington that afternoon, said the ceiling was so low he'd had to keep his plane close to the treetops the entire way. None of this would have been alarming if weather forecasting hadn't been more art than science. In fact, conditions were poor enough that McCord decided at the last minute not to fly the Akron's Curtiss F-9C-2 fighters aboard. Instead, the N-2Y-1 trainer, a two-seater biplane nicknamed the running boat, would take their place. That way, if Moffat or his guest wanted to leave early, they could be flown back to Lakehurst. Serving on a big rigid was far more prestigious for the Navy's sky sailors than a lowly blimp. Importantly, a 50% increase in salary called flight pay was earned for flying 4 or more hours per month. This meant a lot during the Depression when a Navy salary didn't go very far. With Moffat on board, the crew were confident they'd fly that night. In other words, they were sure to get their bonus. This would be Moffat's 12th flight aboard the Akron. He'd flown her more times than her commanding officer, McCord. As the mobile mooring mast began towing the airship out of her hangar, the Admiral found an unobtrusive spot in the control car and settled down to watch preparations for takeoff. As the Akron's crew scrambled to get things ready, the temperature outside was a chilly 41 degrees Fahrenheit, the cloud ceiling an oppressive 300 feet. There were plenty of buildings taller than 300 feet in New York City, just across the Hudson. Skyscrapers were easily spotted during the day, but flying in the clouds at night could lead to a collision in the days before radar. No wonder McCord had grounded his aeroplanes. Only Moffat's airships would be out in this soup. The Akron was finally ready for takeoff at 1928 hours. That's when McCord leaned out the control car window and, lifting a cardboard megaphone to his mouth, issued the most counterintuitive command in the U.S. Navy, "Up ship!" As the ground handlers released the landlines tethering the Akron to Earth, the mighty airship, with Admiral Moffat and 75 souls aboard, rose slowly into the sky. Within a minute, she'd vanished in the clouds as if erased by nature. It was the first of many indications that that night's training flight would be anything but routine. Of the 76 men on board the Akron that night, 12 were officers, 57 enlisted men, and 7 were guests, including Rear Admiral Moffat, Moffat's naval aide, Commander Henry B. Cecil, Moffat's VIP guest, Arthur F. Majory, and Lakehurst's commanding officer, Commander Fred T. Berry. 3. A Night to Remember. If the Akron appeared fragile, she was at least twice as strong as the Los Angeles, the Navy's previous big rigid. As Moffat boasted, the Akron was not only the best airship that has ever been built, she is the safest. The Akron punched through the fog at 1,500 feet, the lights of Lakehurst making the clouds glow beneath her. Her mission was simple, arrive at Newport, Rhode Island by 0700 hours to begin calibrating the radio direction finder stations along the New England coast. The task was mundane, but important. Aircraft needed radio beacons to navigate in the days before radar, and without them, they got lost. But the route to Newport was fogged in, so McCord ordered the Akron to head inland where visibility was better. Once the skies cleared, they could make the 3-hour dash across Long Island Sound. Until then, it was imprudent to bring the running boat aboard, so McCord radioed the pilot, Lieutenant Trapnell, to wait until morning when the weather cleared. As McCord set course for Philadelphia, Moffat observed how the officers interacted in the control car, a telling sign of how well a ship was run. The admiral had a rule when flying: don't interfere with operations. But he'd already violated it that morning when he phoned Lakehurst to make sure the weather didn't prevent their departure. A Big Rigid's control car is surprisingly small compared to the vast size of her hull. Attached to the airship's underbelly like a barnacle on a whale, it was positioned 200 feet from her bow and 600 feet from her stern. Offering a commanding view of the world below, it was not a comfortable place for those afraid of heights. Additionally, the airship's hull was so huge that its curvature prevented those on the bridge from seeing any part of her stern other than her bottom tail fin. Cut off from the rest of the crew overhead, save for the telephone and a single ladder leading into the airship above them, those in the control car were in a world of their own. As long as a city bus, the oval-shaped structure was divided into three compartments: the forwardmost compartment or bridge, the navigator's compartment in the middle, and the gun room aft, which was more often used for smoking. The bridge was the Akron's nerve center. This is where her engine telegraphs were located. They not only signaled speed to her 8 engine compartments spread through the ship, but forward, reverse, and the angle of her propellers. The airship's flight controls, her helm and elevator wheels, were also located here. The Akron needed both if she was to operate in 3 dimensions. The elevator wheel, located on the port side of the bridge, was responsible for altitude control. The actual elevators were on the Akron's horizontal tail fins. Operating like the flaps on an aeroplane, they enabled the airship to rise or descend depending on how much and in which direction, clockwise or anti-clockwise, the wheel was turned. An altimeter, inclinometer, vertimeter, and superheat meter were located near the station. There was also a series of small chalkboards above the windows on the port and starboard side. These boards were used to record the weight of the airship's fuel and ballast water, as well as its remaining helium. Important information if the ship was to maintain her equilibrium. Piloting an airship was as much about maths as anything else. As one officer put it, they flew it with a slide rule. Beneath the chalkboards hung a row of toggles which were used to drop ballast. There was also a set of toggles that could be pulled in an emergency when ballast or fuel needed to be dumped immediately to lighten the ship. The helm enabled the airship to turn either port or starboard. Located at waist level, and surprisingly small for a ship's wheel, it was made of metal. The helm was connected to the rudders on the Akron's vertical tail fins by cables hundreds of feet long. These cables were kept taut by a series of pulleys, sheaves, and slack adjusters. One complete turn of the Akron's helm moved her rudder 5 degrees, but being an airship, she was slow to respond. People tend to equate dirigibles with aeroplanes because both fly, but they're more like submarines than anything else. The sky is as fluid a medium as water, with similar changes in temperature, pressure, and flow. This is why airships, like submarines, had to make constant adjustments to maintain their equilibrium. It also explains why they employ a ballast system, something no aeroplane would ever require. Just as submarines face a limit on how deep they can dive, airships are limited by how high they can fly. Fly too high, and the thinning air caused their helium to expand so much it risked bursting their gas cells. The helmsman held the most commanding position on the bridge. Standing in the forwardmost part of the compartment with nothing in front of him but floor-to-ceiling windows, he had an unobstructed view of the world. The Akron's executive officer, XO, Wiley, who was stationed near the helm while McCord stood near the elevator wheel in the aft section of the bridge. As many as 11 men could crowd onto the bridge at one time, including the captain, his XO, the officer of the deck, the helmsman, the elevator man, and their reliefs. This was a lot of men for such a small space, but everyone knew his role, so things functioned smoothly. That evening, as the Akron headed towards Philadelphia, the bridge was blacked out to preserve the crew's night vision. Suspended above the darkness, with only a few dim instrument lights illuminating their faces, it must have felt lonely. Less than an inch of alloyed metal separated the men from the black abyss below, but it wasn't something they thought about. Still, the control car's swaying motion, combined with the wind blowing in through the open windows, reminded the bridge crew that the Akron flew at the mercy of the elements. As the night wore on, Moffat's VIP, Masury, sat in the navigator's compartment, looking increasingly worried. Separated from the bridge by a sliding door, the compartment was where the navigator plotted the airship's course while sitting at a large flat table fastened to the floor to keep it from sliding. The control car's third or aft compartment had a ladder leading into the airship overhead, as well as exit stairs embedded in the floor that could be lowered to the ground once the Akron landed. Moffat remained in the control car for the first 2 hours of the flight. He knew his way around an airship, given the many times he'd flown aboard the Navy's big rigids. Although too old to be a Navy pilot, Moffat had qualified as a naval observer, meaning he could fly as navigator, co-pilot, or support personnel on Navy planes. As a result, he was more than comfortable in the air. As the fog slowly dissipated, the ground below became visible. In another month, they would be able to stop worrying about winter storms. But for now, clearing skies was an encouraging sign. By the time the Akron reached Philadelphia, the weather had improved enough that the city's lights could be seen twinkling below. Next, McCord ordered a southwesterly course to Wilmington using the Delaware River as a guide. Airships were low-flying aircraft, rarely venturing above 5,000 feet. If they did, the valve on their gas cells would automatically vent helium to prevent them from bursting. But airships needed helium to stay aloft, so they avoided exceeding pressure height whenever possible. Usually, the Akron maintained an altitude between 1,500 and 2,500 feet. Slightly higher than the Empire State Building, it was close enough to the ground that geographical features such as rivers and railroad tracks could be used for navigation. It's possible retirement was on Moffat's mind that night. It was almost certain that he'd be tapped to join the board of the International Zeppelin Transport Company, given that his VIP that night was a director. If not, there was another Goodyear-sponsored company focused on Pacific airship travel that would be interested in retaining the admiral. Such positions were prestigious and well compensated. Importantly, they'd allow Moffat to continue the lighter-than-air work he'd begun at the BUAER. Whatever problems his rigid airship program was experiencing, Moffat was confident they could be ironed out before he retired. Every experimental program suffered setbacks, and rigid airships were no exception, but Moffat was convinced of their utility. He felt certain, given enough time and money, the Akron would prove naysayers wrong. Once they passed Philadelphia, Wiley felt things were under control enough that the XO decided to take a smoking break in the aft compartment. At 2,000 hours, the Akron reported, "All well," to Lakehurst. 15 minutes later, Moffat passed Wiley as he climbed the ladder into the giant erector set overhead. Stepping onto the port catwalk, which ran the length of the ship, Moffat headed towards the officer's wardroom. Along the way, Moffat encountered Richard E. Deal standing watch. The bosun's mate, second class, had flown with Moffat on all three of the Navy's big rigids. He was famous for having missed the Shenandoah's final flight when he switched places at the last minute with another elevator man wanting to visit relatives in St. Louis. When the Shenandoah's control car plunged to the ground, killing everyone inside, Deal's shipmates nicknamed him Lucky, as in Lucky Deal. He got even luckier when he later married the widow of the man who'd replaced him aboard the Shenandoah.
"You on watch, sailor?" Moffat asked.
"Yes, sir. I have the telephone at this station."
After a pause, Deal added,
"You must like flying on this ship, Admiral."
"I'm very fond of it," Moffat replied. "Much more so than the others. It is much better than the Shenandoah."
As the two men conversed, they balanced upon the impossibly narrow catwalk, only 13 inches wide. The catwalk, also called a gangway, was covered in cork to provide a secure grip,
but there was only a thin wire cable running its length to use as a handhold. Not only did the Akron's engines cause the catwalk to vibrate, they swayed every time the ship was raked by a gust. One misstep could send a man plunging through the airship's canvas covering to their death more than 1,000 feet below. When the two men finished speaking, Moffat slid past Deal in an effortless pas de deux, not giving the danger a second thought. It wasn't until the Akron reached Wilmington at 20:30 hours that lightning was spotted. Wiley, still smoking in the aft compartment, felt all 8 of her engines come online. Taking this as a signal to return to the bridge, he noticed McCord had also changed course and was now heading in an easterly direction. As lightning continued flashing in the south, McCord instructed Wiley to get the latest weather forecast. Exiting the control car, Wiley climbed into the airship overhead, making for the aerology office. When he arrived, he discovered that static from the storm had interfered with radio reception, so they'd only received 2/3 of the 8 o'clock weather map. Wiley didn't need the entire map, however, to see a severe low-pressure system over Washington was heading their way. "What do you think?" McCord asked Wiley after he returned with the news. "We certainly have a storm down there," Wiley replied, before suggesting they take a westerly course to escape it. Airships had 2 options to avoid a storm. They could try to outrun it or fly around it. One thing they couldn't do was fly above it, since most storms exceeded pressure height. The safest choice was not to fly at all, but that wasn't an option Moffat encouraged. Flying west to avoid a storm was standard practice for the Navy's rigid airships. Most storms followed a northeasterly direction before heading out to sea. But McCord claimed to see lightning to the west as well as the south, so he ignored Wiley's suggestion and chose an easterly course instead. It wasn't the first time the Akron CO had ignored his XO's advice. Though both men acted professionally, there was tension between them, especially since Wiley was more experienced. At first glance, you'd have thought the two men had a lot in common. Both were Midwesterners who'd attended the U.S. Naval Academy within 4 years of each other. But Wiley was a second-generation airship officer, making him a member of the old guard. In contrast, McCord was third generation, recruited to the program several years later. This meant Wiley had served nearly twice as many hours aboard airships as McCord, yet Wiley reported to McCord because he was junior in rank. Wiley had 4,000 hours on airships compared with McCord's 2,250. Moffat had created this awkward situation by recruiting high-ranking officers to his LTA program, believing they would draw more water in a Navy dominated by the surface fleet. But Moffat's policy caused resentment among long-term LTAers. Not only did it lead to crowding in the program's upper ranks, it slowed promotion for more experienced men. It was bad enough that the Akron had 3 commanding officers in 18 months, 2 of them demonstrably less experienced than Wiley, but Wiley had once commanded the Los Angeles. Serving as McCord's first officer was a step down for him. To make matters worse, McCord treated Wiley with disdain. This rubbed Wiley the wrong way, but he had to submit if he hoped to replace his commanding officer one day. In the meantime, the situation was less than satisfactory. Lucky Deal arrived in the control car to relieve the elevator man a few minutes before 2100 hours. As the lightning outside increased, McCord ordered another course change, this time heading northeast towards Asbury Park in New Jersey. But the fog returned as the Akron neared the coast. At the same time, powerful gusts began raking the airship as rain drummed on her canvas hull. Counting the seconds between lightning flash and thunderclap, Wiley realized the storm was catching up to them. As McCord and Wiley searched for an escape route, the fog outside the control car windows was so thick they couldn't see far. Deal white-knuckled the elevator wheel as he struggled to maintain the airship's altitude. The elevator was the trickiest station on the bridge, requiring equal doses of nerve, strength, and endurance. After years of experience, Deal had a finely tuned instinct for flying, but controlling a big rigid in the middle of a storm was exhausting. As Deal fought to keep the airship level, he could feel every one of her 200 tons in the screaming muscles of his forearms. At 2200 hours, he took a break, handing over the elevator wheel to his relief. Heading for the navigator's compartment, he found Moffat's VIP looking nervous.
"It's pretty bad, isn't it?"
Masri asked.
"There's nothing to worry about, Colonel," Deal replied. "We've been in worse storms than this. You should have been with us in the Shenandoah, coming from Buffalo back in 1924. The lightning was so bad, the control car seemed a ball of fire."
It was a point of pride among airship veterans to brag about how much worse a previous storm had been. After reassuring Masri he had nothing to fear, Deal headed to the aft compartment for a smoke. By the time they'd reached the New Jersey coast, visibility was zero. McCord had tried flying above the fog, only to find they were hemmed in by low-hanging clouds. Since lightning continued to plague them, he decided their safest bet was to head out to sea. Flying east over the Atlantic, he'd planned on eventually turning south to circumvent the storm. But this made little sense to Wiley, who was sure a westerly course was best. He had no choice, however. He had to comply with his captain's order. As the Akron headed over the Atlantic, she quickly encountered the full force of the storm. Lightning could be seen playing around her airspeed indicator, which trailed beneath the control car, while her radio antenna had to be reeled in and out so many times to avoid a lightning strike that a fire control unit was detailed to stand by. As proof of its virulence, the storm's interference was so great, the Akron's radio was of little use. Unable to broadcast her position, she was effectively cut off from the world. By 2300 hours, it was clear to everyone in the control car they'd flown into the heart of the storm. McCord, still looking for an escape, ordered the airship back to shore. It was impossible to know where they were, as the storm had rendered the ship's radio direction finder useless. And though they'd tried dropping flares to check their position, they were just swallowed up by the fog. McCord thought they might be over Asbury Park, but visibility was so poor he couldn't be sure. Complicating matters, the weather made a landing impossible, even if they succeeded in finding Lakehurst. What neither McCord nor Wiley realized was the storm they'd encountered was one of the most violent to hit the East Coast in a decade. If they'd headed west, as Wiley had suggested, they might have escaped the worst of it. But now it was too late. There was no safe place to run. Worried they might collide with a skyscraper over New York City, McCord ordered the Akron back out to sea. But once over the Atlantic, the storm grew fiercer. Every time a powerful gust broadsided the ship, the Akron shuddered, causing her mechano-set-like skeleton to creak, vibrate, or sway. Wiley guessed they were near the heart of the storm, but it was hard to know for sure. It had been 5 hours since they'd left Lakehurst when, shortly after midnight, Moffat returned to the control car. The Admiral seemed only slightly impressed by the storm, remarking to Wiley, "Almost as bad as the one we struck in Alabama." Spreading his feet to counteract the ship's roll, the Admiral seemed to be enjoying himself. After watching for a few minutes, he retired to the aft compartment to smoke his pipe. Then, at 15 minutes after midnight, the Akron hit a severe downdraft.
"We're falling!" the elevator man shouted.
As the elevator wheel spun out of his hands, a relief stepped in to grab it. Since the Akron's fate depended on her altitude, Wiley jumped in to lend a hand. While the men on the bridge fought to keep their airship from plummeting, the Akron fell to 1,100 feet. McCord ordered ballast drop to slow her descent, but the ship was slow to respond. As thunder crackled like cannon fire, McCord rang up the engines for more speed. Meanwhile, Wiley yanked the toggles, emptying the midship ballast bags. When the Akron reached 950 feet, Wiley pulled the bow's emergency ballast toggles, dumping 1,600 pounds of water into the sea. Hopefully, it would slow their descent. Lighter-than-air physics are such that nothing happens quickly on an airship. Whether dropping ballast, venting helium, or turning to port, every command has a delayed effect. After what seemed like an eternity, the Akron finally leveled off at 700 feet, then began to climb. When she reached an altitude of 1,300 feet, the crew's relief was palatable. Reports vary as to whether the Akron leveled out at 700 or 800 feet, as well as her degree of inclination, which may have ranged as high as 45 degrees. Either way, it was a dire situation. For the next few minutes, everything seemed fine. Then the Akron flew into a second downdraft, this one more severe than the first. Once again, the airship plunged at a stomach-churning rate. McCord called for more elevator to counteract her nose-up incline, but when the airship dropped to 800 feet, the end seemed near. Sounding 5 shrill blasts over the telephone howlers, Wiley sent the crew inside the ship running to their landing stations. Moments later, a sickening lurch racked the Queen of the Skies. For a moment, Wiley thought they'd been hit by a gust, but when the helmsman reported the rudder unresponsive, he was convinced the airship had broken in two. When a 200-ton object, flying at 70 miles per hour, meets an unyielding surface, disaster is inevitable. What Wiley didn't realize is that the Akron hadn't broken in half. She'd flown into the Atlantic stern first, ripping off her bottom tail fin. As the airship's 8 engines labored mightily to lift her out of the water, they probably did as much damage as the hungry waves determined to swallow her. When the control car finally emerged from the clouds at 300 feet, Wiley could see the water below rising up to meet them. "Stand by for crash," he called out. Like a birdhouse nailed to a slowly falling tree, the Akron's control car timbered towards the ocean. Wiley braced himself to keep upright. In the meantime, all conversation on the bridge ceased as the men contemplated their fate. Soon, the pride of the Navy's LTA program was going to sink into the Atlantic, and there was nothing Moffett, McCord, or Wiley could do to stop it. 4. Fight for survival. It was 15 minutes after midnight when Metal Smith Second Class Moody E. Irwin felt the Akron plummet. The ship dropped so precipitously, Irwin, who was catching some shut-eye, had to grab hold of his bunk to keep from tumbling out. Hearing the call for off-duty crew to assemble in the bow, the 28-year-old Tennessee native exited the compartment, pumped full of adrenaline. Seconds later, the Akron hit the water. When the Akron's stern collided with the sea, her forward momentum made quick work of her bottom tail fin, allowing water to flood the vessel. But the rest of the airship remained high in the sky, slanting at a crazy angle. As Irwin joined the growing knot of men on the steeply tilting catwalk, he could see the airship coming apart around him. First, one of the girders overhead gave way, blocking his path. Next, a petrol tank tore loose, plowing through the men gathered on the catwalk. The tank left 3 gashes on Irwin's hip before slamming into another man, knocking him aft, never to be seen again. But that didn't stop Irwin and the rest of the crew from fighting their way towards the bow. Forced to climb up the catwalk on his toes, Irwin grabbed anything he could to keep from falling. As the ocean poured into the Akron's stern, the shriek of twisting metal could be heard throughout the ship. When freezing water reached her 2 aft engines, a tremendous hiss followed by a cloud of steam. Moments later, the lights went out. It was every man for himself after that. Trapped near the bow, Irwin made a split-second decision. Diving through the Akron's outer cover, he plunged 30 feet into the sea below. Irwin was a strong swimmer, but the frigid water was so shocking it squeezed the breath out of him. Then, the ship rolled on top of him. Fearful of becoming tangled in its wreckage, Irwin dove deep as the Akron chased after him. When he resurfaced, he'd cleared the wreck, but was so chilled he couldn't stop his teeth from chattering. At first, Irwin thought he could swim to shore, but there was no shore in sight to swim towards. Given that he was afraid of sharks, he kicked the water furiously, hoping to scare them away. As huge waves regularly dunked him, a heavy rain continued to fall. Finally, a lightning flash illuminated a fuel tank bobbing 20 yards away. Irwin fought the roiling sea with every stroke. When he finally reached the tank, 2 men were already clinging to it. One was the Akron's chief radio operator, Lieutenant Robert W. Copeland, the other, mechanic Lucius Rutan. A couple of 100 yards away, the Akron's bow stuck out of the ocean. As she continued to sink, Irwin heard the cries of at least a dozen men in the darkness around him. With each passing minute, they grew fainter. Richard Lucky Deal was resting in his bunk in the enlisted men's quarters when Chief Bosun's mate Carl Dean rushed in. "All hands forward," Dean shouted. Since the compartment had no ceiling, Deal was watching helium gas cell number 7 billowing overhead. But when the Akron suddenly lurched, he was shocked to see 2 longitudinal girders connecting 2 of her main rings snap in half. Deal grabbed a pair of wire cutters before heading towards the bow, thinking they might be needed if he had to snip a slip tank. The gangway's inclination was so steep it felt like scaling a mountain. Deal grabbed what he could for support, but the lights inside the ship went out. Shortly thereafter, he felt his feet get wet. Trapped inside the sinking airship, Deal soon found himself in chest-deep water. When a fuel tank struck his head, it momentarily stunned him. Struggling to free his feet from the wreckage, Deal swallowed copious amounts of seawater. When he finally escaped the sinking ship, the ocean was so rough he couldn't survive without something to stay afloat. As the storm raged around him, Deal saw his fellow crewmen struggling in the water. He wanted to help, but it took every ounce of his energy to keep afloat. When a lightning flash illuminated a 120-gallon fuel tank bobbing nearby, Deal tried reaching it but was too weak to swim all the way. Moody Irwin, hanging on to the tank, saw his shipmate go under. Reaching out, he pulled Deal to the surface.
"Who's here?"
Deal asked, catching his breath.
"Rutan and Copeland," Irwin responded.
The four men clung to the cylindrical fuel tank, but it kept rolling in the waves, shrugging them off. Meanwhile, two phosphorus flares, ignited by the water, lit up the sea and revealed a hellscape straight out of a Hieronymus Bosch painting. Irwin, Deal, Copeland, and Rutan floated in the frigid Atlantic for at least half an hour. Suffering from hypothermia, they shivered uncontrollably as their speech began to slur and their pulse weakened. Of the four, Rutan and Copeland were in the worst shape. Copeland's face was a twisted grimace, and neither man had energy to speak. When a wave swept Deal into the sea, he spotted a hole in the tank that was letting water in. Deal tried plugging it, but it was hard to stop the flow. Locking hands with Irwin, Deal hoped to stop the tank from rolling, but it was an impossible task. When a wave knocked Rutan off the tank, he was too exhausted to save himself. The last Deal saw of him was an outstretched hand slipping beneath the waves. By this time, a comforting warmth had begun to spread through Irwin's chest, the final stage of hypothermia before death set in. When the control car finally smacked down on the ocean, it was with such force it crushed the aft compartment. Seconds later, the car filled with icy water, then rolling onto its side, disappeared beneath the sea. But before the car vanished, a wave washed Wiley out the portside window. He swam underwater for as long as he could, hoping to escape the wreckage. When he finally surfaced, it was in a thick cloud of fog. Wiley heard the cries of his drowning crew, but the towering whitecaps quickly separated the Akron's first officer from his men. He thought about swimming back to the airship 400 yards away, but needed to rest first. As luck would have it, a board drifted by, which he grabbed. Spotting a man struggling in the water, Wiley tried to help him, but a wave forced him under. When Wiley resurfaced, the man was gone. As the mortally wounded Akron receded in the night, waves tossed Wiley like a bathtub toy. At one point, he heard the cries of Irwin and Deal, but wasn't sure where they were. In the meantime, McCord, Massery, and Moffat were nowhere to be seen. Wiley was an excellent swimmer, but if he wasn't rescued soon, he'd die of hypothermia. Floating on his board to conserve energy, he was left to endure the pummeling of the storm. The world's biggest, most expensive aircraft sank off Barnegat Light shortly after midnight on Tuesday, 4 April 1933. Although Copeland, her radio operator, managed to get an SOS out before losing electricity, static from the storm rendered most radio receivers inoperable. Trapped inside the sinking ship, the crew cut through her outer envelope using the knives they'd been issued. Those that escaped swam away as fast as possible to avoid being pulled down by the wreck. But where could they go in a raging storm 25 miles off the coast of New Jersey? The average water temperature in April was 46 degrees Fahrenheit, although some reports suggest it was colder. The longest a person can survive in water that chilly is 20 minutes, and that's not taking into account towering waves, gale-force winds, and a driving rain. On top of that, many of the Akron's crew didn't know how to swim. Given that the Akron's life belts were still in the hangar at Lakehurst, the crew was at immediate risk of drowning. To make matters worse, the Navy not only didn't know where the Akron had crashed, no one even knew she was missing.
The Phoebus, a German-flagged oil tanker, was bound for Tampico, Mexico when the Akron went down. Having left New York City earlier that day, she'd been blown off course by the storm. Since the weather was terrible, her 34-year-old captain, Carl Daldorf, was on the bridge when he spotted lights off the starboard bow at 0023 hours. Daldorf realized the lights couldn't be a ship because they hung in the sky.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.